Thank you so much, gentlemen. Thank you. I now request Sri Tarun Sridhar, Secretary, ADF, Department of Animal Husbandry, Dairying and Fisheries, Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare, Government of India, to kindly give the keynote address.
Ladies and gentlemen, well, it's indeed a great privilege as well as an honor for me to be participating in this annual symposium. Now, most of the associations call it their annual session, the general body meeting, but I'm very happy that you call it a symposium and give it a theme, because it attaches a sense of great purpose and focus to a gathering of this nature. Now, before I proceed further, I would also like to commend DRAFMA for honoring the outstanding professionals for their contribution in this field, and my special regards and compliments to the four professionals who have been honored today: Dr. Pushottamam, Dr. Vishnu Sharma, Dr. Falke, and Dr. Mahesh. It's an honor to be associated with this. My personal association with DRAFMA and its members and office bearers goes back to the year 2008, I think. And then since 2008 to 2013, we used to have regular interaction. And thereafter, this relationship suddenly snapped. You forgot me and I forgot you. You went your way and I went my way. But our paths were destined to cross again. And I'm glad that they have crossed. And I'm glad that they have crossed well. Well, while I was traveling from the airport to this hotel, before that I had been wondering, nowhere I was finding what is the full form of DRAFMA. I went to the internet, I did search, etc. Everywhere it was DRAFMA. Then the site was DRAFMAIndia.org, everything. I then recollect it's either cattle and livestock or compound livestock. No, I didn't know how to expose my ignorance or how to hide my ignorance. But then I gathered some courage and I asked Dr. Suresh Devara to enlighten me. So then I realized it's compound livestock manufacturers association. But he says, no, now we have DRAFMA India. Now we have DRAFMA India. It's like we used to have Gas Authority of India Limited, now it's GAIL India. Probably next generations, generation next won't know it was compound livestock manufacturers association. It is clever. Well, having said that, I'm really, really glad that I'm here. Now, on an occasion like this, the guest has to say good things about the So I'll say good things not because I have to say, because I'll say good things because I've observed certain good things. One thing which really impresses me about DRAFMA is that this is not an organization merely of people who are in the business. It's an organization people who are in the business because they are also professionally committed to this business. And most of you are, I think, believe the first generation entrepreneurs. Am I right? Most of you are first generation entrepreneurs in this business. And you are actually concerned about the next generation. And I, honestly speaking, it was not in my mind that the subject is going to be the generation next and the dire need for innovation and introducing innovative technologies. It is just that I happened to again talking to Dr. Suresh Jura. I was asking him, is the next generation also as enthused about this industry or business or not? Because what I'm feeling and seeing and observing all across the country is that livestock sector is a sector which is somehow not very attractive for the coming generation. As we call, this is not a sexy sector. There's no glamour in it, so people are not really interested. So there's a challenge before us, how to make this sector very, very attractive. Now, a lot of, Mr. Sundararajan was giving a lot of figures and data. Now, figures, there's a lot of figures and data I can also, I'd also like to quote some because that somehow further bolsters the argument in favor of the sector. But somehow within the ambit of the larger sector of agriculture, globally as also nationally, the livestock sector has to have to play a second fiddle. Despite the fact that everybody agrees that the rate of growth and the contribution to the farmer's income and the contribution towards food security and nutritional security of livestock sector is as important, if not more, than crop husbandry. Last year, the theme of your symposium was doubling farmers' income. And I'm sure everybody would have said that if you have to double farmers' income, you have to invest not only financially, but also in terms of technology, in terms of professional commitment, more in the livestock and fishery sector than you do it in crop husbandry sector. Now, I would request tomorrow, although your this thing is fixed, just spend half an hour in taking stock of what happened over the last 1 year in terms of the various suggestions which would have come in your symposium. You're all professionals. My understanding and knowledge of the sector is more on account of the files and the government documents and papers I read. Your understanding and knowledge of the sector is a hands-on knowledge of the sector which you observe 24/7 in your professions. So that's the difference. So I would request that let us sit and take stock as to where we have moved in terms of doubling farmers' income and what has been the positive impact which the livestock sector has made, if it has made any. And is it on account of some conscious policy decisions and some conscious initiatives which we took as professionals in this sector or not? Why am I saying it is that globally the scenario in terms of providing food and nutritional security to large populations is a really, really huge challenge. I believe the present global population is about 7.5 billion souls. By the year 2050, the demographic estimate is that the global population will be 9.8 billion. 9.8 billion. Most of this population will be in Asia and Africa, which are the poorer segments of the global population. How do you feed these people and provide them not only with basic food security, but provide them with healthy nutrition security? That is again where livestock sector is going to play a very critical role. One very positive global trend is that especially in the 20th century, there has been exponential growth in the livestock sector in terms of the number of animals which are farmed, be it poultry. What is the global population of poultry? I believe it is more than 20 billion now. We have more than 1.5 billion cattle, more than 1 billion sheep. Fish. Till about few years back, the contribution of aquaculture to the global fish production was only 35%. Now it is close to 50%. Right now it is about 49% of the global fish production is contributed by aquaculture and 51% by captured fisheries. And by the year 2025, more than 70% of the fish would come by way of aquaculture. That is where the criticality of the feed sector which you are representing becomes very, very important, and especially innovations for Indian livestock sector. Mr. Sundararajan, I think you also would also mention in terms of where we stand. Now, while just globally the livestock sector is growing both in numbers and in productivity, we are also huge. In fact, whenever we talk of any sector, we say India is number two. No guesses for who is number one. So China is number one, India is number two in everything, be it population, production, or whatever it is. Now, in livestock sector also, by and large, you can fit this. Although we'll say we are the biggest milk producer in the world. Although, our, again, milk cattle productivity is one of the poorest in the world. We are the second or third biggest egg producer in the world, but our poultry productivity is again at a lower end. Now, there are many initiatives which are coming up in terms of interventions to not only increase the production but also increase the productivity. But in the process, what has been happening in our intervention and livestock sector is, with too much of focus on production and productivity, we are not integrating it with the various other subsidiary and allied sectors like feed, etc. All of you would be knowing that right now India is sitting on a huge pile of 2.5 lakh tons of milk powder, butter and ghee. And this stock in the times to come is going to rise, and we do not know what to do about it. Why has it happened? It has happened because of our very, very proactive approach to increase production. We started registering a very impressive growth of more than 6% as far as milk production is concerned. But the consumption and utilization was growing only at 2.5%. So, which means that while our intentions towards the sector and our policies towards the sector were well thought of, they were somehow not integrated. So, my first request would be that when we talk in terms of innovations for Indian livestock sector, let us talk of the entire sector, not only of feed. That is why I am impressed with this. Where if we start talking of feed and do not link it with the kind of production, productivity and the characteristics of the growth are there, we may be probably missing the tree from the woods. We are taking many new initiatives in livestock sector as also the subsectors of livestock. Genomics is one. We recently sanctioned two huge projects wherein in the next one decade, probably most of our cattle and buffaloes will be genomically tagged. We are having, we've already made health cards for close to 1 million cattle, and probably in the next few years, all the milk cattle will be covered with the health cards. Now, in this case, when this is happening, the demand on the quality and the components of the feed will also start keep changing. You would be knowing in many places like Rajasthan and some places in Karnataka, etc., ration balancing program has started taking place. Now, when the ration balancing starts taking place, right now it is only balancing what is available. Thereafter, there would be requirement of a balancing what are the ingredients in a particular. Why I am listing all these things is that all these sectors have to collectively move and think together. If I am doing genomic tagging, you are doing your feed independent, etc. So tomorrow there may be a mismatch. Another big ticket item which the government of India has now done is we have recently sanctioned three projects is artificial insemination through sex sorted semen. Now if this is successful, probably again all the other supporting industries will need to change the dynamics of their functioning. Aquaculture, I mentioned, more and more fish produced to aquaculture, greater and would be the demand on the on your sector. Plus the environmental concerns of a large amount of fish meal going into the aquaculture feed. And demand from the slightly sophisticated high-end consumers that they will not consume any fish which is fed with fish meal would again put a challenge as to how the sector moves. So that is why I think when you talk in terms of innovations in livestock sector, all these issues need to be addressed and a very holistic view needs to be taken. I was Well, I would be very happy to take the credit. You mentioned that about this Venomation, and I was being given credit for introduction of that film. Well, thank you so much. But let me just tell you how it happened. Why I'm going to tell you is that good things happen only if we work collectively. If we work individually, good things will happen to you only. Good things won't happen to society and the country. I had no idea what manami is. I had never eaten shrimp in my life. I still don't eat fish. It is only on account of inputs and the awareness and knowledge generated in me by professionals like you. The professionals like you that, well, the shrimp industry is undergoing a lot of crisis because of this white spot syndrome virus, which had affected almost 90% of the hatcheries and farms. We didn't know what to do. Now, as Joint Secretary sitting in the Ministry, I am not a fish doctor or a fish scientist, etc. It is the professional scientists, people who are engaged in fish production, aquaculture production, who started giving this feedback, and that is how it led to. That is why I remember that interaction with you. When we listen to you, when you give your representation, it also always helps us. And that is how national level policies should be made. And they should take on board the concerns and inputs from each and every stakeholder, right from farmers to the businessman, to the trader, to the policy maker. The chairman mentioned a few issues. One of the issues you mentioned was GST. I think you had, Dr. Phalke was also there, you had come and discussed it with me and given a representation with respect to the rate of GST, which was artificially jacking up the prices of the feed and putting some stress on the industry. Now, I'm sure you are aware that we have already taken up this matter with the Ministry of Finance and requested them to place it before the GST Council. But now let me put the very harsh reality also before you. There is no point in my saying I'll go back and again take it up forcefully, which of course I will. But as far as the rates of GST on various items, on various industries are concerned, they are competing demands. They are competing demands from various listings, and every industry, every sector has a very, very strong argument in favor of reducing the GST. For instance, GST on ghee and butter. Now, dairy industry is rightly saying that ghee and butter, if the GST is high, how do you expect this product to be taken up? We'll take it up again, but my request to you would be that as an industry, you please list out the arguments and the impact a higher rate of GST has on the man who is at the bottommost step of the ladder, which is the farmer. Why? Because our ministry was used to be Ministry of Agriculture. Thereafter, its name was changed to Ministry of Agriculture and Cooperation. But now, in this government, the name has been changed to Ministry of Agriculture, Cooperation and Farmers' Welfare. So, when you give an argument, wherein the policymaker, whether it is at bureaucratic level or at the political level, feels concerned, well, this argument which you are giving is going to benefit the last man in the boat. It's very interesting. See, we have a very huge midday meal scheme all across the country in the schools. Then we have this nutrition scheme through Anganwadis. Most of the states are not giving milk either in the nutrition scheme or in the Anganwadis, whereas milk provides the best nutrition. Now, we start, our dairy industry starts pleading the cause. Why they are pleading the cause? Rightly so. Here we have 2.5 lakh tons of milk. Here your children are not getting milk. But the argument given was not that it is a very, milk is a source of high quality nutrition for children. So if you provide milk as a nutrition to children, their health would be improved, they would be resistant to diseases, etc., etc. They said, there's a huge pile of stocks lying with us, therefore you introduce it in India meals. So it was not to improve the health and nutritional status of children, it was to help my business. So my request would you be, to you would be that when you give an argument for any financial benefit, be it taxation or a subsidy, etc., your argument has to be an argument which impresses us. Argument is not that my profit margins are impacted, therefore you do it. Argument has to be that the cost of input for the farmer is going up and the cost of production for the farmer is impacted. GMO issue. Now I agree with you, the GMO issue, it has to be level playing field. Now I'll not go into the merit of whether you should have GMO feed or GMO components in the feed or not, so that let the concerned scientists think there should be a level playing field. Now with the access to American poultry in our country, the poultry industry, including you, have to now, I'm sure you must be thinking that suppose, well, right now consignments have started coming. If tomorrow huge consignments from America come and our consumers start preferring American poultry to Indian poultry, how would you meet that situation? I'm sure the industry would be sitting and doing it. But level playing field, yes. So what we have suggested to is two things. One is allow us to import feed which has GMO components. You mentioned DDGS is one, etc. We have formally and in the meetings also we clearly say allow our industry to import. If you don't allow our industry to import, then don't allow them to use it. This is something we have taken it up, and this GEAC, is for GEAC?